I want to turn the floor over now to Justin Beaulieu from the Red Lake Nation. And we had him go last because, as I mentioned, they're just now at the very early stages of constitutional reform, and Justin has been charged with the grand task of trying to get his community fully engaged in this effort, and hopefully at the end of the day come out with a new constitution and system of governance that they feel like they have full ownership in. So Justin.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll start with a brief history of Red Lake. As Chairwoman Irma Visner alluded to, we are in northern Minnesota. We are not one of the Minnesota Chippewa tribes, though. We don't have the issue of jurisdiction that a lot of tribes have because we're a fully closed reservation. We don't have the state coming in, and we just deal mainly with the federal government. So that's something that is a blessing on our side. And that was from the foresight of our ancestors a long time ago when the land grabs were going on, when the allotment and the Dawes Act, and they just they fought it, and they thought to themselves, we have a lot of resources here, so let's use this as leverage. Let's say, okay, we'll give you this 11 million acres, but we want to keep this piece here for us. This will be ours. And even during the negotiations, the Indian agents would come in and they'd say, you only have 2,000 or 2,500 people in your tribe. You're never going to use this much land. This is really good land. It's really great agricultural land. And at that point in time, they had about 3 million acres. So they decided, during these negotiations, they said, okay, we'll give up this other 2.5 million acres, but we want to keep this for us because we are going to have children and our children are going to have children. And at some point in time, we are going to keep growing. And at some point in time, we're going to need all of this land. And it's going to be important to us. This is our land. And that isn't even the Ojibwe way of thinking, our land. But during that time, you had to claim stake to something or somebody else would take it from you. So before I go really deep into this, I just wanted to honor our chairman who's here sitting here. So he's been a blessing to me. He's been a great supporter of our project, which is good because the council's hands off on the constitution reform, but in the same sense they do support us from behind. So I just wanted to honor Chairman Siki for coming to support me. Thank you, sir. And I'm really humbled and honored to be here because these are some really great people. I've learned a lot from these people over the years, and looking at what we can do as a tribe. How are we gonna identify with our people? We have people that are on a continuum. We're dealing with people who have maybe a high school education if they're we have people who have PhDs. We have people who went to school through sixth grade, had to drop out, had to do something, had to work with the family. So we're trying to figure out how are we going to engage all of these people in this conversation about governance. And when they're worried about keeping food in their refrigerator, or they're worried about keeping their lights on, or they're worried about, these are real things that they go through, and how do you have that conversation then with them to say, where do you see our tribe in 50 years? Where do you see our tribe in 20 years? What does governance look like to you? And we get to throw around all these cool buzzwords like transparency and separation of powers and legitimate governance systems and legitimate court systems, and they have really no idea really what that means. So that's the first thing that we looked at is, How do we then take what we have right now in our constitutions and then we apply that with our culture and we look at what is going to happen in the next 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, 100 years. And on our committee, we're blessed because we have a professor from the University of Minnesota, so she has all these graduate students that she can say, hey, you do this and you do that and you do. So they're doing these studies for us. They're doing environmental studies. They're doing these great things for us so we can kind of look into the future. If everybody had a crystal ball, everything in this world would be easy. You'd know what to do, when to do it, how to do it, why to do it. We don't have that luxury. So, looking at some of these studies and what it's going to mean to us, what's going to happen to our forests, what's going to happen, to our water resources, which are going to become amazingly scarce. And the lake that we have up north in Red Lake, it is one of the cleanest lakes probably in the world because we don't have boats on there every single day, hundreds and thousands of boats on there over the seasons fishing, and so we don't have that pollution there. And so our water is very sacred, and that lake is very sacred to us. So how do we protect that? Because in our constitution currently, we have an IRA constitution, but we're not an IRA tribe because it took about 22 years for our tribe to work with the BIA to negotiate with them to say, okay, you can be an IRA tribe. Because before that, in 1918, with our constitution, they wanted our land, obviously, but they also wanted our timber resources because there was lumber barons coming in. You had huge towns. Detroit was booming, you know, in the 20s and 30s, and you had Minneapolis and Milwaukee, and so they wanted that lumber because it was easy. They could throw that lumber on the Mississippi River right from where Red Lake starts and just shoot it right down to Minneapolis and zoom it off into these metropolitan areas where they're trying to build these huge buildings everywhere. So they were coming up and they needed a way to negotiate that. So back then they made the Constitution in 1918 because they needed somebody to go to say, you can sign off X on this so we can have your resources, so we can use your resources. And so it was working really well. And the BIA said, you know, the way things are going right now, we don't really want to change it. You know, we kind of want to keep it the way it is because it's going good. We can negotiate well with you. You know, we don't have any issues with you. You guys are way up in, you know, Minnesota and rural Minnesota, so we don't really care so much about you because we use most of your resources. Excuse me. So then now we're looking at that now. Like, how do we change that now? How do we look at that now? Because we're also combating these preconceived notions with some of our members, well, not some of them, a lot of them. They see this honor and distinguish of these, you know, these governing documents that were created, and they were created by our people, but they weren't. You know, it was a boilerplate thing that was passed off and that they tried to get passed. But in their minds, they see this as, well, our ancestors created this document. We need to honor it. So then I'll bring up, you know, like 10 or 15 other constitutions, and we can set them down and say, we'll take the names off and say, which one is the Red Lakes? And they'll look at it and they'll say, well, they all are. Exactly. These are all different constitutions from different tribes, but this is the one that we have for Red Lake. And it doesn't match who we are. It doesn't talk about the things that we hold sacred. It doesn't talk about the land. It doesn't talk about our children. It doesn't talk about our culture, our language, our elders. It doesn't, all these things that we view as important through us, through who we are as a people, none of that is included in that document. And so they're like, well, we need to change that. Okay, so let's talk about that. You know, how are we going to do that? And so that's where we're at. We're in the negotiation kind of point right now with our people. And we have these constitution reform community engagement meetings. And it's hard to get people to come there. You got to, you know, offer them food, obviously, number one. Indians won't go nowhere unless you give them food. And then then we got to offer them a prize, you know, something that they can use. So first we were looking at things like, you know, that kind of identified with our culture, like some beadwork and things like that, some wild rice. And then we weren't getting as many people, so then we offered some tablets and computers. And all of a sudden we got more people coming because, you know, they're like, we need those, you know. My kid needs that for this, or, you know, so it. We're looking at how can we match their needs with our needs so we can get that information from them, because they're not gonna get that ownership and they're not gonna get the buy-in that we need from them as a people until they're part of that process. You know, we want that document to be the people's. So at some point in time, once we have everything documented and go back, I wish they would have documented everything for us because we've done so much research for so long and why everything happened, why this happened, why that happened, you know, who was the governor at the time, why was it, you know, what was their relationship with this county and with, you know, with our tribe. And so all of that stuff, you know, we're doing these mapping the dots to here and all that. That's probably why they did that, and okay, that makes sense why they did that. But we're, you know, with us, we're documenting it, so we know why we're doing these things. We talk to our constituents in this district, and this is what they thought, and this is why they thought that, you know. So it's easier for them, and hopefully in the future it'll be easier for them to identify things like legislative intent. If it goes to court and we have codes and laws written about this, and they won't have to say, well, we're not quite sure why they did that, so we're going to just make a guess and we're going to apply it that way. And then when something else comes up, well, we don't know why they did that either, so we'll make a guess. Now you'll be able to see, you know, what the people thought, what their wishes were, what they identified with, what they thought was important. And for us, it's not an easy process. It's not easy trying to engage 12,000 people in constitution reform when they live all over the United States, in Canada, you know, overseas. But at the same time, if we don't include them, we're talking about their future. We're talking about their children's future. We're talking about, you know, a thing that our ancestors fought really hard for. They died there. They bled there. You know, that's their families, and we're still their families. So identifying what then they would want to see. And that's one of the things when we talk to the elders, and they ask us questions about, why do you want to change this, or what do you think about this? You know, the elders didn't get the opportunity like I did to go to college, you know, or to go work on, with Ian, you know, on Native Nations. Or they don't work with Harvard Honor Nations program. They don't know about these things. So it's a time for us then as a committee to sit down and try to help educate as to what we've learned from other tribes and what we can then benefit from that, and what can we do with that information then to kind of custom tailor it to who we are as an Ojibwe people, as Anishinaabe. So it's been a really fun and exciting, taxing, stressing, lots of hours. But if how many tribes in here are thinking about doing constitution reform? How many already are doing constitution reform? Okay. And so, like, you guys on the continuum, you guys, some of you who are already in the process, you know kind of what I'm talking about. And you know some of the stories that they shared, you know, how they resound with you. But constitution reform, it's about sovereignty, you know. It's about who we are, and it's about identifying that on a piece of paper. A lot of tribes had constitutions a long time ago. They didn't write them down. One story from college when I was going to American Studies, and the teacher, she said, we're going to start with American history at, basically when the white people came. So why don't we start it before that? And she said, because the Indians didn't write down their history, so it's not important. And I said, well, the dinosaurs didn't write down theirs either, but we study them, you know. And she, and she kicked me out of the class, and I was okay with it. But it's one of those things about finding that legitimacy and identifying, you know, through the oral histories and remembering who we are and going back to that, and also then looking at where we're at and how does that fit then with who we are as a people within the dominance. You know, I say dominant, which just because it's all around the dominant culture, you know, and how do we then fit in with our intergovernmental relationships. And that's what the Constitution is about. It's about writing down who we are, what we're all about, and then being able to say, this is the people's document, and this is going to be here for our kids, our grandkids, our great-grandkids, and hopefully at some time, if things change into a manner where it's, a lot of things have changed in my lifetime, and I'm not very old, so I can only imagine, you know, some of you have seen some amazing changes. So within that time frame, if this changes in 20 years and none of this is relevant, I hope that they change it. I hope that they change it because things need to evolve. They need to evolve with the time. It doesn't mean that we're going to change who we are as a people. As long as we look at those core values and who we are in our cultural aspect, and keeping our language and keeping our ceremonies, then that's always going to be there. That doesn't mean we can't be on Twitter or we can't go on Facebook, but we got to make sure that what we're doing as a tribe is going to match who we are as a people. Because if we lose sight of that, then what are we turning into? Then we are a business council. Then ultimately we're just making decisions for dollars and cents, not for our families, you know? And that's what's important, keeping those family ties strong. And that's a lot of the people who we talk to, and that's what they say, you know, my kids can't get enrolled, or my grandkids can't get enrolled, and you need to change that, and I can't change that, you know? It's just like, I don't have a magic wand. So we're talking about that through the process, because right now, with our current constitution, it's resolution driven. So if, like say for example, the council does a huge turnover, they can pass a resolution that says that they're going to change how our membership is, because in our constitution it says, you know, membership is going to be decided based off of tribal resolution. And we look to our leaders then, and they'll say, you know, change it. But who knows what to change it to? Who knows what that's going to be? So that's going to take comprehensive studies, and then people have all these differing opinions and ideas. Someone will say, well, my kid only needs a little bit, so let's just drop it down to a 1/8 blood quantum. Or, and you know, someone will say, well, you know, my kid, his father's from another tribe, so let's just include other tribal blood and keep it at 1/4. So you have all these people that are on that continuum trying to figure out, you know, what's going to be best for me. And that's one of the things that, you know, we have done, you know, recently, is we're always thinking, like, what's best for me? What's best for me? What's best for my family? And it needs to be what's best for our people. What's gonna help us move into the next century, the next generation? What's gonna help make sure that our family ties are strong, that our kids aren't being disincluded, that they feel like they belong somewhere, that we have a school that's got 1,500 kids who aren't actual tribal members, but they've lived every second of their life on a reservation. You know, what sense does that make? just because the government said a long time ago in 1700s that they wanted to make sure the Indians didn't vote in Virginia, so they made blood quantum, a fake science. Do we use any science that came from the 1700s nowadays? No, we don't, except in Indian country with blood quantum, you know, because that's, it means something to people. Over the years, they've decided that, well, I'm a full blood, so I'm better than you, or you're from this tribe, you know, and you only have half, so you're not as important, or your voice isn't important. We're family, you know? We're family. We're family members. We're community members. And so that's one of the things that we try to talk to with the people when they have these conversations, because it gets real heated, you know? Somebody wants it on this side, somebody wants it on that side, and then they start arguing, and it's like, hold on. You guys all have valid points, and it means a lot to get your guys' input. And it's not something to get angry about. It's something to get excited about, because we can talk to each other, and we can find that common ground. And then from that common ground, we can decide then, is that going to help our people in the future? And that's what we're looking at. Each aspect of our Constitution is based off of what we get for feedback. What's going to help our people? And, you know, telling the future, what's going to be changing with our resources? Are we going to need to protect our lake even more? Because, you know, water resources are going to be something coming up that's going to be, it's going to be a very hot topic. There's, if you take, for example, California recently, look at what happened with the water down there. And if we have a lake that's, you know, 800 square miles around, that's a lot of water. People are going to want that. But that comes through us. And that was essentially, I guess, it was given to us by the great white grandfather. But it's something that we now have, and it's a resource of ours. So we need to be able to protect that. And the only way we're going to protect that is if we work together, we unify, we have a strong government, and we assert ourselves in those governmental structures. We go to Congress, and we lobby for things that are important to us, and we help our brothers who are close to us. The divide and conquer mentality should go out the door. It should have happened a long time ago. But for Red Lake, it's about our families, it's about our communities, it's about our culture, it's about our language, it's about our children, it's about our elders, and it's about supporting each other. And so once we get that Constitution done, we're hoping that's what it does. It's basically a roadmap to what it means to be a Red Laker and what it means to do business or intergovernmental, you know, stuff with Red Lake. So with that, I don't have anything else to contribute, I don't think. So...